1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, it's the national underground thunderbounds, and I stop the ground like a million elephants, a silverback around.
Hello, fellow ATLians and lovers of the cast. It's Joycelyn Wilson, OutKast scholar, producer, professor of hip hop studies and digital media, and contributor to The Bitter Southerner. I'm here sitting in the infamous Stankonia Studios, located in Atlanta's West Midtown, to reflect on the 20th anniversary of Big Boi and André 3000's fourth album, Stankonia. Given we are living in the middle of a world health crisis, a civil rights movement, and an election that is set to tilt the Earth's axis no matter who wins, it seems relevant to celebrate the album's impact as a culture-shifting collection of fast-paced lyricism and bombastic production styles. So, on this segment of the Hip Hop Snob, we explore the education of OutKast Stankonia. Power, music, electric revival. We revisit some of the album's hidden activisms and what they reveal 20 years following the album's release about the politically charged times we are living in and how they can add value as a teaching tool. So let's get started. Let's begin with the album cover. Okay, hands down, Stankonia was OutKast's last great album as a duo. Yeah, we had Speaker Box and The Love Below. These are great sets of art that personified their individual styles. Stankonia, however, was their magnum opus, as it was a culmination of what the South had to say about the South, the world, and what was happening in it. War, invasion, complacency, resilience in the culture. Since their first album, Southernplayalisticadillacmuzik, Stankonia was also the first album that was not an Afro-futuristic illustration of their union and cultural identity. Nope. On this album, Michael Levine kept the imagery still, but loud. Subtle, yet critical. Speculative and realistic. Funky and stanky. In front of a black and white American flag, Big's hair is unbraided. A smirk, no smile, just a white tee, a Dungeon Family chain, and a lean André 3000 is shirtless, standing slightly behind his brother, both staring dead into the camera in solidarity. One thing that stood out to me are the number of stars revealed in the final cover photo. I count 23. What about you? Which one, with one behind Big Boi's head, it followed the same pattern? It makes me wonder if this was done purposefully, consciously or unconsciously, in mathematics, because 23 is a prime number, which means it can only be divided by one and itself. In spirituality, Psalms 23 is the scripture of God's protection. And in sports, we all know that 23 is the retired jersey number of MJ, Michael Jordan. Could they be hinting at something godlike? All of us humans have 23 chromosomes in our genetic makeup. Could they be expressing what they really feel in that we're all outcast and more alike than we're different? I'd like to argue that they knew this was their best album to date when it was released in 2000. Stankonia went on to win Best Rap Album at the 2002 Grammys and Best Rap Performance for a Duo for Miss Jackson. The loudness of the album also drew in another audience that hip-hop wasn't really into at the time, and that's the intergalacticness of the ravers. They, too, wanted to visit the center of the stank. So, what is Stankonia? Well, first, we know OutKast is well-versed in creating new musical innovations, but also new linguistic innovations. Southern Playalistic is a portmanteau of Southern Playa, Cadillac, and music. ATLians is a remix of aliens, but with the ATL. Aquemini is a mashup of Aquarius and Gemini, and Stankonia, created by André 3000, is another portmanteau of Stank, a synonym for James Brown's funk, and Plutonia, the title of a futuristic city illustrated on a poster that hung in André 3000's bedroom. As a place and ontological concept, Big Boi described it as whatever is the funkiest shit ever. It's African, the place where all funky things come from. André 3000 in the album's intro, just after a robotic spelling of OutKast and before Gasoline Dreams, describes Stankonia as the center of the earth, 7 light years below sea level. the place from which all funky things come. So this is some otherworldly music, and it requires a level of open-minded thinking for one to understand it and enjoy it. So let's start. Stankonia, the album, was released October 31st, 2000 by Aristillaface Records. The album debuted at number 2 on the Billboard 200 chart, selling over 530,000 copies, more than rock group U2. I like U2, but I like OutKast better. There are some samples on the album, of course, but not many, probably 3. There are 24 dope tracks, 3 of which were singles, Bombs Over Baghdad, Miss Jackson, and So Fresh and So Clean, like my shoes. Given that this album came out in 2000 and it was being worked on in 1999, there are several current events that could have influenced the album. When it comes to Bombs Over Baghdad, war was happening in 1999. Perhaps this is why many top 40 stations wouldn't play the song, because it had the word bomb in it and Baghdad and the word over. So let's go to song number 1. Now that we've got all of that uncovered and we've talked about some of the basics, let's get into some of these songs. I want to start with Gasoline Dreams, especially when it says, "Don't everybody like the smell of gasoline? Well, burn, motherfucker, burn American dreams. Don't everybody like the taste of apple pie? Well, snap for your slice of life, I'm telling you why. I hear that Mother Nature's now on birth control. The coldest pimp be looking for somebody to hold. The highway up to heaven got a crook on the toll. Youth full of fire and got nowhere to go, nowhere to go." Wow, Gasoline Dreams is a critique of justice, hands down. Honestly, it could have been a single. It should have been a single. I like the way André 3000 starts off screaming, "All right, all right, all right, all right," over an electric guitar riff just before he comes in with that hook I just read. Once again, in their outcastian way, Big and Dre paint a picture of scenarios steeped in truth, struggle, and justice. According to these two MCs, the struggle towards life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness is attached to the idea of reaching the American dream. You know what I mean? The house, 2.5 children. I don't know how you get 0.5 children, but that's what the statistics say. And a dog named Champ. Yeah, that American dream. But what's the opposite of that idea? What happens when that dream goes up in flames? When access to resources, food, healthcare, spirituality, you know, the sweet things of life, are only made available to some and not others. These are resources that many kill for, folks rise up against, folks rob, crime increases, war ensues. But the last line is the coldest in the song because it speaks to the youth. It says that youth are full of fire and got nowhere to go, because it points to how many of today's youth then and now find themselves caught up in the consequences of decisions made by their elders. Think about now, 2020 versus 2000. There's still protests, there's still panic, folks are self-medicating, and many of them are out voting and trying to change the course of things, because in many ways, the dreams have gone up in flames. Struggle and resilience are consistent themes throughout Gasoline Dreams, making me wonder, imagine if Dr. King's dream turned into a gasoline dream. Shoo, many wonder if it has gone up in flames already, given our current climate. Needless to say, Gasoline Dreams teaches us that the struggle continues. Fortunately, however, struggle is temporary. In times like 2000, when this song was written, and now when we reflect on it, Corona has forced us to take a step back, assess our lives, and reevaluate what's going on around us in order to get to that next level, regardless of what happens on November 3rd. So, don't everybody like the smell of gasoline and the taste of American pie? Yes. So let's flip it. Go ahead and pour gasoline on whatever might be holding you back from your God-given destiny. Now's the time to do it. Stankonia reminds us of that. Let's get to song number 2, Bombs Over Baghdad, perhaps my favorite. Because if you scroll to 2 minutes and 55 seconds, you'll see me waving my hands in the air like I just don't care. Fun fact, just a little fun fact. This song is so timely because we are living in a B.O.B. moment. we are in a bombs over Baghdad moment worldwide. In the October 2005 issue of Blender magazine, André 3000 explained that he got the title when he was just on tour in London. He was listening to the news and the lady said something about bombs over Baghdad and they liked it and they used it. Used it is an understatement. This is probably the most famous OutKast song ever. If you got a top 10 list, Bombs Over Baghdad is on it. I mean, think about when he says, weatherman telling us it ain't gonna rain. So now we sitting in a drop top soaking wet, in a silk suit trying not to sweat, hitting somersaults without the net, just taking all types of risk. But this will be the year that we won't forget. Oh, that was 1999. We're in 2020. We definitely won't be forgetting this year. But he goes on to say, long as you know consequences are given for living, the fence is too high to jump in jail, too low to dig, I might just touch hell hot. Get a life, now they're gonna sell. Then I might catch you a spell. Look at what came in the mail. A scale and some Arm & Hammer. This that trap talk. But if you are not listening, you'll miss it. So he goes on to say, cure for cancer, cure for AIDS, make me want to stay on tour for days, get back home, things are wrong, but not really, it was bad all along. Like, I mean, the hook of this song is a teachable moment. They take on so much in Bombs Over Baghdad. It's a lot to process and it's a lot to miss, especially if you get caught up in the dancing from the song. Isn't this a dope track though? It's like Kraftwerk's Numbers on steroids. But anyway, let's just look at the part that says the weatherman telling us it ain't gonna rain, but it does. And the part where he says, get back home, things are wrong, but not really, it was bad all along. This is a critique of fake news and the idea that the weather is changing right before our eyes so rapidly that the weatherman can't even keep up. Again, climate control, environmental injustice. How do we know what to believe? How do we know who to trust? Especially when that blind trust can lead us into dark times or dark situations as we're in right now. And we're definitely experiencing a dark time. So the consequences for living are just too real, especially when you're Black, as well as you're male. And with these recent Black Lives Matters events, we're definitely living in that moment. So this song also reminds me of something I refer to in my research as the trap aesthetic. The trap aesthetic is a cultural concept for understanding the impact of the American South on hip hop culture. I credit OutKast and Goody Mob for introducing this language to the culture. We'll save that for another video. But anyway, trying to sling dope and make a living for yourself and your family can have consequences. The hook tells us that. Big Boi tells us that. I mean, there are so many hidden yet overt messages in this song, so don't pull your thing out unless you plan to bang. In other words, don't start none, won't be none. It's such a simple message to follow. I also love how OutKast drills down on the theme of sequence and order in Bombs Over Baghdad. I mean, it's consistent with their catalog. A case in point is when Big Boi says, before you re-up, get a laptop. Make a business for yourself, boy. Set some goals. Make a fat diamond out of dusty coals. I mean, that's order. That's sequence. That's crawling before you walk. It matches the resilience in the hook where André says, hello, ghetto, let your brain breathe. Believe there's always more. Ow! Don't pull the thing out unless you plan to bang. Okay, anyway. Song number three. Humble Mumble. In my opinion, Humble Mumble should have also been a single. I mean, I keep saying that, but definitely it should have. The entire song is a favorite of mine. I love Big's verse on it. It's one of my favorites, and I'm going to get to that in a second. I love the hook. I love the messaging in the hook. I love, for example, when they use cracker instead of cookie. Like, is cracker some sort of code for white person? Perhaps more collectively white supremacy. I mean, they do say, I guess I gotta reroute my dreams. And, you know, these institutions make us reroute our dreams. Both of their verses, Big and Dre, one of my main issues I take with journalists and scholars I want to point out here is, you know, they try to compare the two. They try to act like one artist is better than the other, like Run was somehow better than DMC, or that Eric Sermon was somehow better than Parrish Smith. I hate how some music critics made it seem like André 3000 was a star MC and Big was like some kind of subordinate. We know that to not be true. It wasn't true then, it's not true now. And I have rejected this notion since 94, and I do so 26 years later. Because I love Big's verse when he says, life is like a great big roller coaster. Everything in life don't happen like it's supposed to. Trials and tribulations make you stronger, live longer. You wanna reach the nation, boy, star from your corner. Everything don't always happen like you want it. Well, he says, everything don't always happen like you plan it. Demand it, overstand it, then you handle it. He goes on to say, fuck wishing. You missing the ambition on your mission. Now you switching. Why you quitting? Because it's heated in the kitchen? Like, life is going to get hard, but you got to push. You got to push. We're in a moment right now where it's really heated in the kitchen, but we got to keep going. These first few lines really show that things don't always turn out like they're supposed to or they're planned. But these detours build character, Big tell us. Then we start talking about the nation. He says, start from the home and build out versus trying to fix problems on the outside of the home. It kind of reminds me of the saying, make sure your house is in order first before you try to fix somebody else's. We get into wishes and dreams after that. Stop wishing and start working to achieve your goals is what Big tells us in this verse. It's about the hustle mindset and the mentality. This song speaks to all of that, this idea of keeping going. But that hook, humble as a mumble in the jungle of shots and screams. That's the way the cracker crumbles. So I guess I got to reroute my dreams. Is this a critique of institutionalized racism and white supremacy? I mean, the saying usually goes, that's the way the cookie crumbles, not the cracker crumbles. As if to say, well, that's how this thing is set up for the humble, those trying to live, those navigating their dreams amongst oppressive institutions and policies. At the end of the song, or at the beginning of the song, André says, I stank I can, I stank I can. We are all the little engines who can. It's important to remember this in the times that we are experiencing. Stankonia is more relevant now than it was 20 years ago, as it was released at the turn of the century. We are now 20 years in, and where are things? Stankonia has transcended time and space. We can learn a lot from this album, actually, like open-minded thinking about race and politics and the impact they have on our day-to-day lives. It can teach us about resilience and hardships, but how we've overcome them or how we can overcome them. As with Black expression, we learn about community truths and the tool of storytelling as an act of resilience. We're able to examine these texts to understand that current events and their impact us all. It's too bad these two Southern philosophers are still on a creative sabbatical. But they did not leave us without some key life lessons. So what can we gain celebrating an album like Stankonia? While you're preparing your thoughts, I'll tell you what I've learned from this album. Number one, the universe gives us breakthroughs when we strive to live a life of balance and harmony. That as much as we work, we must also relax. That as much as we love self, we must love others more. That as much as we serve self, we find our blessings in serving others. And that I must put on my oxygen first before I can help anybody else breathe, especially breathe freely. Oh, I almost forgot. I also learned from Bombs Over Baghdad to start nothing that I can't finish. That if I break it, I bought it. I think OutKast in their totality is a formidable case to study race and politics, but also balance and harmony. While this might sound easy, all of us know that the stress of work, the stress of family, the stress of friends, the stress of money, the stress of disease like COVID and racism can throw us off our groove just as fast, just like a bad DJ. But more than anything, Stankonia teaches us about love of self. Stankonia teaches us about love of spirit and the communities we navigate. Speaking of communities, don't forget that November 3rd is right around the corner. That's all from me. I'm about to go bump this album again. Y'all take care. Peace.